Anticoagulant therapy is always a major challenge requiring a thorough risk-benefit analysis. The first part of my talk is therefore to evaluate the risk of bleeding in ICU patients on renal replacement therapy. This study assessed bleeding rates and consequences in the cohort of medical surgical ICU patients of the PROTECT study. As you can see, bleeding occurs in 13.1% of patients and was classified as major in 5.6%. The patients with major bleeding were more likely to be transfused and had higher ICU and hospital mortality. Major bleeding was observed in 26.9% out of the 502 patients. But, as you can see, only one-third of them had received a systemic heparin for circuit anticoagulation. And in the multivariate analysis, as you can see, renal replacement therapy, one was of the numerous independent factors for major bleeding. And the increased risk of major bleeding conferred by renal replacement therapy may reflect platelet dysfunction related to renal failure rather than systemic anticoagulation, since most of these RT procedures were intermittent and associated with saline flushes. So the first part of my talk is to say that critical patients on renal replacement therapy are at higher risk of major bleeding, even so they did not receive any systemic anticoagulation for maintaining their circuit patency. Patients with active bleeding or patients at very high risk of bleeding can be treated with renal replacement therapy without any anticoagulants. In this case, I think it is better to use intermittent hemodialysis because it is associated with short duration sessions and high blood flow in the extracorporeal circuit. However, as shown in these two studies, you can see that continuous technique can also be safely performed without anticoagulant and are associated with acceptable filter lifespan between 20 hours and 32 hours. In this case, a predilutional technique is preferable. And, for instance, if you look at the renal study, you can see that one-third of all the sessions were performed without any anticoagulants. In patients receiving predilutional CRRT with no anticoagulants, saline flushes administered every 30 minutes can be used with an acceptable efficacy. As you can see, saline regarding filter life, as you can see there, 23 hours for saline and 21 for heparin. And regarding the delivery dialysis dose, in the saline group, the RIRA ratio was 0.85 and it was 0.82 in the heparin group. However, blood in the extracorporeal circuit tends to clot because of various factors, including the non-laminar flow within the catheter and the circuits, the interactions between the membrane and the blood, the air-blood interface in the bubble trap, and the HEMO concentration. In addition, sepsis is a leading cause of AKI, and at the early phase of sepsis, patients may develop a procoagulant state because of the interplay between coagulation and inflammation. This hypercoagulable state is exacerbated during AKI because AKI is a systematic inflammatory condition and leads to the accumulation of circulating cytokines and other inflammatory mediators. Circuit clotting is a major problem in renal replacement therapy, decreasing the dialysis dose delivery and increasing blood loss, workload, and cost. Circuit anticoagulation is therefore suitable for maintaining circuit patency. UFH, low molecular weight heparins, and regional citrate anticoagulation are the highest accepted anticoagulant strategies in ICUs. Heparin is the most widely used anticoagulant for secure anticoagulation because it is inexpensive, easy to administer, simple to monitor, and can be reversed with protamine. Its half-life is short, about 90 minutes, increasing to up to 3 hours in renal insufficiency because of accumulation of smaller fragments. In patients with normal coagulation, a simple scheme could consist of a bolus followed by a continuous infusion adjusted on the results of the clotting test. UFH can be monitored either by APTT or by determination of anti-factor 10 activity, despite the weak evidence. As you can see, in patients receiving heparin anticoagulation for continuous techniques, there is an inverse relationship between increased APTT and decreased filter clotting incidence. There is no target for APTT ratio or for anti-10 activity levels. However, most authors consider that APTT ratio should be maintained below 2 and anti-10 activity below 0.7 units to prevent over anticoagulation. While prolonging filter life, heparin increases bleeding. In recent study comparing citrat and heparin circuit anticoagulation, the median circuit life range in the heparin group between 13 and 40 hours. EDTA-ERA recommends low molecular weight pairings for dialysis sessions in end-stage disease patients because low molecular weight pairings have several advantages over UFH, including a lower incidence of HIT, a less platelet and leukocyte activation, a less affinity for antithrombin, and low molecular weight heparin are less inactivated by PF4. They can be administered either at fixed dose or to achieve or adjust the dose to achieve a systemic anti-factor 10A activity levels between 0.25 and 0.35. This is a randomized controlled crossover study comparing enoxaparin and UFH during CVVHF. And as you can see, enoxaparin was safely used and resulted in higher filter lifespan compared with UFH. Whenever HIT is diagnosed or suspected, all heparins must be stopped and replaced by an alternative anticoagulant such as danaparoid or argatroban. There are several protocols of danaparoid or argatroban circuit anticoagulation which have been published. In patients with no severe liver failure and suspicion of HIT, argatroban is probably the drug of choice because of its pharmacokinetics properties. Citrat inhibits the clotting cascade and thrombin generation by chelating calcium. It forms a complex with ionized calcium, which is partly removed by filtration and dialysis. The remaining complexes enter the systemic circulation and are metabolized in the liver or other tissue, producing 3 molecules of bicarbonate for each molecule of citrat. Calcium replacement is infused post-filter to replace the extracorporeal losses of citrat, either in post-filter directly or via an alternate site. Citrat infusion is infused pre-filter with a targeted concentration between 3 and 6 millimoles per liter to achieve a pre-filter ionized calcium concentration below 0.35 millimoles per liter, which is usually sufficient for regional anticoagulation. Some protocols administer citrat pre-filter at fixed dose in relation to the blood pump. Others adjust the citrat infusion according to the post-filter ionized calcium concentration. Regional citrat anticoagulation may induce several adverse events, including metabolic alkalosis because of the higher buffer load, metabolic acidosis because the altered citrat metabolism, hypernatremia because high concentration sodium solutions of citrat, dialysate and replacement fluids, hypomagnesemia and hyper or hypocalcemia depending on excessive or inadequate calcium replacement. Citrate accumulation syndrome is a very rare but severe potential fatal complication. It results from altered or inadequate citrate metabolism. It occurs mainly in patients with very severe liver failure. It induces anion gap metabolic acidosis, hypocalcemia, hypotension, arrhythmia, shock, and possibly death. The diagnosis can be suspected by a total calcium to ionized calcium ratio above 2.2. When the ratio is above 2.5, citrate accumulation syndrome is diagnosed and we must stop the technique. In an ancient study published in the 2000s in surgical patients, regional citrate accumulation was regional citrate anticoagulation was associated with survival improvement. The results of this study was not confirmed in subsequent reports. However, all meta-analyses have found that regional citrate anticoagulation was more effective than UFH in maintaining circuit patency and in reducing the risk of bleeding. As you can see, several trials have been published since the publication of this meta-analysis, and all found the same results. Diminution in the incidence of filter clot and diminution in the risk of bleeding when using regional citrate anticoagulation. In addition, several reports have shown that the regional citrate anticoagulation can be safely used for sustained low efficiency dialysis in AKI. This is an original study which compared two types of regional anticoagulation. There you have regional citrate anticoagulation, and there you have heparin protamine and regional anticoagulation. And as you can see, regional citrate anticoagulation prolongs CRT circuit life more than heparin and protamine anticoagulation. My conclusion is, for continuous technique, KDIGO guidelines recommend using regional citrate anticoagulation in patients with no contraindication to citrates. I don't know if there exists really. And using low molecular weight heparins or UFH for patients receiving intermediate hemodialysis. Fourthly, regional citrate anticoagulation may be safely performed. New citrate solution together with improved RRT machines suppose and led that now we can perform more safer and more easily citrate regional anticoagulation. In patients at very high risk of bleeding and contraindication to citrate, intermittent hemodialysis or predilutional CRT with or without saline flushes may be safely performed without any anticoagulation. What we must keep in mind, and I think it is the most important part of my talk, that systemic hemodynamic, access site and diameter of catheter, extracorporeal blood flow, plasmatic filtration fraction, and absence of blood product transfusion through the circuit are of paramount importance for circuit patency and RRT delivery. I thank your attention.